In 2014, there lived in Poland an elderly lady by the name of Janina Kolkiewicz. She was 91 years of age. Sadly, after a short illness, she died. Her body was put in a body bag and she was taken to the local morgue. At the morgue, she was put into one of the large fridges until the time of her burial. During the day, many different workers came in and out of the morgue, some to tidy up, some to clean the floors. 11 hours later, the morticians arrived with another body. They opened the big fridge, and to their horror, they saw the body bag of Janina Kolkiewicz moving. They quickly pulled her out of the fridge, opened the body bag, and found that she was still breathing. She opened her eyes and said, "It's ever so cold in here." They warmed her up with blankets, they gave her some hot soup and 2 pancakes and took her back home. Now, when Lazarus from Bethany died, there was no doubt at all that he really was dead. This was such an astonishing miracle. It is recorded so carefully by the disciple John. It's included as one of the signs confirming the identity of Jesus. John records that Jesus did so many miracles, he could fill the world with books. But this one he chose particularly so that you might believe. It's the most wonderful homely story. The family of Lazarus and his sisters Martha and Mary welcomed Jesus into their home. It's the same for us today. Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me." If you've not opened the door of your heart to Jesus, consider that today. This Jesus was no ordinary man. He was the God-man. In Philippians 2:6 it says, "He was in very nature God." A little boy once said, "Jesus was the best photograph that God had ever had taken." In Colossians 1:15 it says, "He is the image of the invisible God." Charles Wesley wrote in one of his brilliant hymns, "God contracted to a span, incomprehensibly made man." We have glimpses of his God nature in the account. Jesus had received a message that Lazarus was sick, but he delayed visiting the sickbed for 2 days. With his godly foreknowledge, Jesus told his disciples Lazarus was in fact dead, but he was going to raise him up. His disciples couldn't grasp this. The scene changes to Bethany. Eventually, Jesus shows up 4 days late. Have you ever felt like that? The tragedy happens, disaster has occurred. But where is God in all this? Perhaps there's a sense of this in Martha's greeting. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Was there a mild reprimand? A distressed sense of disappointment? The psalmist often expressed his distress and confusion as to why God had allowed adverse events. The psalmist wrote, my God, why have you forsaken me? I cry out day by day, but you do not answer." Don't be afraid to be honest with God. But Martha followed with a wonderful declaration of faith and trust. "But I know that even now, God will hear you whatever you ask." Jesus said, "Your brother will rise again." Here is a double meaning. The God-man predicts the miracle, but it also applies to the end of your time on earth. Martha says, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Let me ask you, do you know that? The atheist Richard Dawkins preaches to his followers, "After death, the brain will decay. That's it." His London bus campaign proclaimed, "There is probably no God." The Bible disagrees. "It is appointed unto man to die, and after that comes judgment." Who are you going to trust? The word of God or the word of man? Jesus replied to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Do you believe this? Notice how personal the question is. Do you believe this? Martha's reply was in the affirmative. She acknowledged Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah, who the prophets predicted hundreds of years ago would come one day to the earth. Then her sister Mary arrives. She has no doubt who Jesus is. She falls at his feet, recognizing he is no ordinary man. The Jewess knew only God should be worshipped. The same statement spills from her lips, the same distressed thought. "Why are you so late?" Don't ever think God is indifferent to your grief. Every life matters to God, especially those who suffer injustice, the innocent, the vulnerable. People like George Floyd, children like James Bulger, Madeleine McCann. As Jesus approached the tomb, overwhelmed with sorrow, he wept with the mourners. Then this most dramatic of miracles. They are reluctant to break open the tomb. After 4 days in the heat of Palestine, the tomb will stink. Nevertheless, they obey his instructions. They heave and lever the huge stone away. Jesus calls out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The mummified form shuffles from the dark interior into the light. The onlookers, utterly astonished, untie him and let him go. How is this possible? The angel Gabriel in Luke 1:37 said, "Nothing is impossible with God." The disciple John wrote, "Jesus was in the beginning with God. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made." King Solomon wrote, "You do not know how the body is formed in a mother's womb. We don't know how the decay of death was reversed, how the DNA molecules were repaired, and breath came back into this body." At the command of Christ, he came alive again, and it didn't take millions of years either. The simple truth of Christianity is this: when you trust in Jesus Christ as Saviour, you are released from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. You are freed from the sin that has bound you. Like John Newton, the previous slave trader, you can say, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see."